So I recently got two of these Video Assist HDR 12G SDI from Blackmagic, but unfortunately one of them just didn't work correctly, which led me to this video, or filming this video, where I actually take this one apart because I'm always curious to see what's inside. But since it doesn't really work properly, I also of course have an excuse, because yeah, I would really like to avoid having to ship this one back here to get it exchanged. But you can see, no matter what format or codec I choose here, all I get is just either dotted lines, and sometimes if I switch between ProRes and DNX HR, I can get some kind of useful picture here. As you can see, it looks all weird, flashy, and yeah, the Video Assist still records just fine. It's just the image itself that is defective. But what really makes a device like this tick? I'm always curious. So let's just disassemble. There is 6 rather big Torx screws. None of them is under any kind of warranty seal or anything like that, so they are all freely available to just unscrew and have a closer look at the device itself. So yeah, of course, takes a few seconds here to get those screws out. And final screw here, and let's have a closer look. Back panel just comes off rather easily. And you can see the cooling solution here inside the device. Rather big aluminium heatsink with an aluminium shroud as well, and the little fan there in the bottom that is always active. Sadly, would have been nice maybe if they had put a bigger passive cooler on there and maybe could have some semi-passive cooling going on. But the little fan is just always cooling. And of course, depending on what kind of screen brightness you have set on this device here, the fan will of course ramp up accordingly. I keep mine at around 50% of screen brightness, and the fan definitely does ramp up throughout the lifespan, or when I turn it on to, of course, when I'm recording, the fan does ramp up a little bit. Still quite a bit less noisy than Ninja 5, for instance, so that's definitely pretty nice. But you can see also the 2 SD card slots there in the left side, and of course some of the components and cable and so on. But let's just dig a little deeper. First off, just removing the shroud and the heatsink, see what kind of CPU, APU, or whatever you want to call it, that make this little device here run. But first off, the heatsink here, you can see there is 3 thermal pads. The big one there, the blue one, is for the CPU, and there is also some, of course, holes there for the little fan, so you can actually drag some air out from the front monitor as well, because like I said, the higher brightness, the more heat you will produce, and it will also suck some of the heat out from that monitor. But this is pretty much the bare motherboard. You see a rather big chip up here, of course, that makes everything work. Encoding, and I don't know if it also shows the images on the screen, but there's also the 4 little RAM modules there, kind of reminiscent of a smartphone or something like that, or maybe even a modern laptop with soldered memory sticks like Apple laptops and so on. But you can see the little CPU there from a Xilinx Sync. I'm not really sure I've heard about this brand before. Ops Ultra Scale Plus, trademarked. Yeah, I've never heard of this brand before, but of course you can always pause this video if you want to read the model numbers on these devices here. 4 memory chips on there as well, but the lighting in my studio just makes it kind of hard to actually see the model number and sizing. And of course, a lot of components that I'm not really aware of. I'm not really into this kind of stuff here. I just like taking things apart and see how well they are put together. But in terms of the electronics and stuff, I'm not really sure. But of course, some kind of power module or power DC-AC converter or whatever there. And let's just dig a little deeper, take out the motherboard and see if any of the cable is actually loose. Sometimes it will work if something is not working properly, like this one here. If you just pull out a cable and put it back in, maybe it will get better contact. So that's kind of what I'm hoping here, but I don't really know. So of course I will have to completely take it apart to just see every kind of components is in here. And I must say, it is definitely held together quite nicely. That metal frame also extend to the siding there where all the ports are, also made of metal. But it takes quite some time to actually get it out there. But of course, I don't really want to damage anything in there. So yeah, takes a few seconds to get the motherboard completely out. And of course, I'm very curious or very careful here as well. Other side of the motherboard, several more components. Big surprise. So yeah, dual layer motherboard. And it is a rather thick motherboard as well, but you can see some of the components here, of course. Let me know down in the comment below if this is something you can tell me more about. I'm not really into this kind of thing, so I don't really know too much about it, but I'm sure all of these components here is actually doing its purpose. But there's a rather few chips on the back side here as well. And like I said, there's also a hole through the motherboard there, so the little fan can actually suck air out from the front display because it will produce a lot of heat there. And of course, a little speaker as well, which is actually kind of nice to have, so you can just test pretty quickly if the audio is working. And yeah, that's pretty much it on this motherboard. And I suspect this up here is in relation to the audio coming into this device through the two mini XLR ports. But yeah, don't really know. Let me know in the comments if you do. Putting this thing back together is kind of a task as well. Relatively easy if you do it correctly the first time. That's it. I did put the heatsink on a little too fast, a little too soon. I forgot there's a little screw actually holding down the motherboard below the heatsink. So definitely do install the heatsink as the last component. Not the way I do it here, where I install it firstly and afterwards realize that it actually is a little screw holding everything of the motherboard in place underneath the heatsink. But the heatsink assembly is actually quite thick and sturdy. So I'm definitely quite impressed by the heating of this device here, or the heatsink of this device. Would I prefer some heat pipes, maybe some bigger heat, passive heatsink, so you could move some more air from this, or more heat, excuse me, from this little CPU more efficiently. And this way, hopefully, make it a little less quiet, even though it's not really all that bad. But you can see here, I'm removing the heatsink again, because I had to put in a screw below the heatsink. So definitely, yeah, install the heatsink last. But when all the screws is back together, took quite some time. There are quite a few screws holding this motherboard in place. And of course, make sure all the cables are installed correctly, wiping off all fingerprints and whatever. I do use anti-static gloves in here. And finally, the unit is completely assembled again and looks like it was brand new when I took it apart. And the last thing to do is, of course, put the shell back on. But before I install all the screws, I just want to check and see if it actually turns on, which it does. And then, of course, just install the six screws there on the back. Rather big torque screws. And they were pretty well tightened inside the device as well. Also have some thread locker on them as well. So I'll just put some thread locker back on there just to be 100% safe. And this takes quite some time because I have to put some thread lock on the screws there as well, but I'm not really recording that part of the video. So, finally complete. It is completely assembled again. So, the million-dollar question here is, does it actually work? So, let's try it out and see if it actually works here. You can see the same video feed going into my Ninja 5, and then from my Ninja 5, go through the video assist rather into my Ninja 5, and I'm filming with this is from my computer, straight into this device. And you can see my Ninja 5 works just fine, no flickering or weird coloring at all. Video assist, unfortunately, still doesn't work, so didn't help at all, so I ended up exchanging it. Took a few weeks, and I've actually received one that is fully functioning, so if you have this issue here, don't try to fix it yourself, just try and replace it as your where you bought it from. Not really sure if this is a common issue or if this is just my unit. I lean towards it's just being my unit. There is always some bad apples between the assembly of these devices here. But everything works. I can record video. It looks fine, but it's just when I have to monitor on this monitor / recorder here, it just doesn't work. So yeah, that's kind of a bummer. But I got a new one. It works. I have two of them. Both of them have worked fine ever since, and I've been recording all of my videos with them for the last few months. So that's pretty much all I had to show for this video. Just as if you're curious, like me, what's inside a device like this, now you know. Let me know down in the comments below if you can identify some of them and you know what exactly they're doing. I would be very interesting to know this. But that's pretty much it. I hope to see you again in a future video. Until then, take care.